questions or make comments.
Should be there, posted underneath the video or wherever it appears. Derek.
what is it? Just
yes.
But it is at Rice and Beans THTR, and you hashtag Cafe Onda, which HowlRound has provided us with, which brings the discussion to a larger context to what's happening to Latino roles across North America right now.
Yes. And apparently Stephen Adley Gorgas is watching us. So Stephen, we really, really, really hope that you will make comments and questions if you feel comfortable doing that. So the first thing that we want to do, so first of all, we don't want to spend a lot of time talking about all the controversy around the open letter and the facts and the information in the letter. We really want to move on rather quickly to the larger issues that interest us. But we do acknowledge that we will have to spend some time clarifying some stuff about the open letter and what led us to write the open letter to begin with. So maybe, Pedro, do you want to start?
Alexandra had heard about it separately, and then I had heard about it separately when someone asked me if I was upset about the casting of Motherfucker with the Hat. And I didn't know at the time. I was like, should I be? And so they said, well, you should read the play. So I read the play. And then I went, okay, why should I be mad? And they told me what the casting was. I'm like, all right, I know why you asked me if I was mad, because there was Latino parts that weren't cast by, with Latinos. At that point, Alexander and I were meeting every once in a while, just like in passing and talking about this. It kept coming up between us and how we felt we needed to do something as young artists in the city and to raise our voices as Latinos towards this. So we didn't really know how, so we reached out to Carmen, who at that point, I mean, Alexander had met her a few times. I had only met Carmen twice, and frankly, you did scare me. I mean, but it, more as in, like, as someone I admired and respected their work and was scared for them to, you know, be like, oh, you're a Latino, which is a problem on a whole other issue that I have. And so we reached out to Carmen, and the three of us had a meeting. We sat down and we talked about the whole process. And Carmen, at that point, told us that she had, I guess I should backtrack. Before that, Carmen had sent her the message that there was casting at the Generals of our hall to be done, and that she urged all her Latino people that she knew to audition. I received that message as well. I chose not to audition because of the way the information was conveyed, whether intentional or not. I didn't want to audition for a part that wasn't open and truly open, as the way I felt and read it. And I saw the Equity call out that said some parts cast, but I never read that the Latino parts were open. So I felt I couldn't submit for a part that wasn't truly open from my perspective, and I didn't. And so that's where Alexandra, and then we met up with Carmen, and we talked about this process, because she had been in conversation with the folks at Haberdashery about the casting, and she had been prepared to write and comment on afterwards, after the show had gone up, about the roles, the Latino roles in the show and how they weren't cast with the Latinos. And I felt that I couldn't let it go on without letting people know that that had happened, I guess, that those parts had been filled with non-Latinos. And I don't know why, I can't tell you why, I just did. And it's something that I've been working towards, embracing this side of me. And so I raised my voice, I said, no, we need to take action beforehand. And then they agreed, and so then we went, how do we do that? And we're like, well, a letter, I guess? I mean, and we talked about the Jesse's open letter that happened, and so at that point we reached out to Real Canadian Theatre, and we said, well, how did you guys go about this? How did you approach reaching out to the Jesse's with your letter? And they met with us, and we talked, and we're still formulating whether or not we were going to do this letter. And as we spoke with Real Canadian Theatre, we decided it was a letter. We needed to put our thoughts down on paper. So we sent it to Haberdashery in the Fire Hall, and then started collecting signatures. At that point, Donna let us know that she wasn't in the country, and at that time we weren't sure if we were going to hold off till she got back, and then we did. We wanted to wait for her to get back so that we could meet with her to publish or send it out to press. And then while she was away, about 3-4 days after we sent Haberdashery the letter, we met with Haberdashery, had a big meeting with them, went back, made amendments to the letter, and then waited for Donna to come back, had another meeting with Donna, had a meeting with Donna when she got back from her vacation, in which we talked about having an open forum, possibly during the run of Haberdashery, but all dates just were not available during the run to have a talk back afterwards or on their dark day. We felt that we wanted to have it on the stage where this was happening. And so then we decided we needed to have a forum with all of you here beforehand went out. So whether you choose to go to see it or not to go see it, you have some more information, or if it makes you curious to go see it, which is great, because we're not saying to not go see it, but then you, we wanted to raise the issues that there was Latino parts that weren't cast with Latinos. And that's where we are here today,
yeah. I feel. And the reason why we want to do this now, as opposed to, we know that there's gonna be another forum in late February or mid to late February, is because our opinion is that for the last, well, quite a few decades, the theater community across Canada has been having this discussion about diversity in the abstract. And it's always talking about the future. So in the abstract, we talk about, oh, there has to be more diversity. Oh, we have to cast more people of color. Oh, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, sometime in the future. And we thought, well, that's working a little bit, but really not a lot, considering that the last equity census states that 46% of equity members believe they are not fairly represented on stage. We thought, well, it might be a little bit revolutionary, which is a word that I like, to actually do it before the show goes up and to reference a concrete example of this happening right here, right now, and what can we do about it, as opposed to some theoretical situation sometime in the future. And that's been very, very scary. And I've been doing this for 25 years, and it's been scary for me. I can only imagine how scary it's been for Pedro and Alexandra. So just to make it super clear, something that you said, we were told directly to our faces in writing, face-to-face, and on the phone in June that the play was 100% cast with a non-Latino, without any Latino actors in those roles. Francisco, who's here tonight, so I'll let Francisco speak to this, was cast in November when the third supporting Latino role, that person stepped down for personal reasons, and that's when he was brought in. If that person had not stepped down, there would be no Latinos in this play, and that is the issue that we are having, very specifically. Before we move on to the bigger issues. Now, Jay, maybe you, I know that Francisco, you wanted to say something. Francisco is a person who's the only Latino who's in the play, and he said he wanted to say something at near the beginning.
Who am I to stop? No, yeah, so
because it's so not intimidating.
No, no, that, just to.
I don't mind. Is I gonna do this in a week?
No, this the mic. You don't have the mic.
Yeah. So, I wanted to speak because I'm in. So Francisco Trujillo. I was born in Chile, but this month it'll be 40 years since I've been in Canada, in Vancouver, and I arrived as a political refugee with my parents, so fleeing for our lives. So I am Latino and I am Canadian, and I have an accent still, and I embrace it. And I'm in the motherfucker with a hat. Really, there's only one person to blame for this, because you always have to start with blame. And that's Stephen Adley Gergis for writing an amazing script. No, so really amazing, a beautiful script, and obviously the wonderful actors that I'm working with in Haberdashery fell in love with it, and Johnny's here from Haberdashery, and he'll be able to explain much more than I can because I wasn't at their roots inception. So, I mean, it's really a thing of the way that I see it is someone loved the script because it is a beautiful script. If any of you know the script or have seen it. And Steve Lobo, who's not here, who is a man of color, I guess he went about and got the right. So Haberdashery, and I would love John to speak because I'm not part of Haberdashery in their inception, but I from being in there, which has been great, I know that they got the right, sort of got the money. They're doing three or four jobs at once besides producing and acting and publicity and all that stuff. Now, speaking with that, which is Haberdashery is a new theater company, and I think this is not about, I think we're all not here to throw stones or blame any one person or any one particular reason why this meeting is going on. It's about communicating, conversing, finding solutions, getting ideas, because we're all artists and that's what we're about. We're about communicating. We're about finding new truths and new ideas and new realities and new experiences that we all, from my, you know, the beautiful faces that I see, we all have different histories and different stories within the theater community. So I chose to be in the play. I was approached by Carmen in June saying, because Carmen and I did do this play in Calgary. This was done in Calgary and we both had parts in it. And Carmen called me in June and did you know that they're doing Mother Fucker with a Hat in Vancouver? I said, no, I had no idea. And then she said, it's a group of actors that have gotten together and they're producing it. And it looks like the Far Hall has come in to co-produce it with Haberdasher. And I said, no, I hadn't heard. And she said, the parts are all cast. And as far as we know, there are no Latinos in the cast. And we know that there are three Latino parts. So Haberdashery will have hopefully John will talk about how their process was in casting, whether it was they started out as a co-op or with friends and said, hey, let's do this play. And I believe that they tried to sell it to the Arts Club and read for a few theaters, hoping to see if someone would help co-produce it.
Should I speak then and get a little bit more accurate?
Yeah. I just want to say, because I have felt because I'm Latino, I'm in the play, and I came in knowing that the process had not been at some point that there was a general audition, because I'm always reading the CBA for auditions and saying, oh, is there a play that I can audition for? Is there something, most of us are always looking at that email saying, oh, can I audition for something that would be great for me? And I never did see it. Again, the process is of the casting. John will.
Can I?
I don't know.
Well, I guess what.
Can I, Jake?
Yes, of course. But I just want to preface a couple of housekeeping things.
Yes.
And also to say that I think this is the prelude to a forum discussion, right?
Yes.
So, we're getting a little bit of background, and we've had an opportunity for Pedro and Carmen to speak a little bit about how they came to it. You had a very eloquent context for your involvement, and I really appreciate how high level everybody's referring to it as. It's like these are the series of events without too much emotional color put to them. I think is great that we're keeping the tenor to that way, and I think if you don't mind, you want to take a couple of minutes, and then we'll get to the forum.
Sorry.
Yeah, no,
I could just briefly maybe try to shed some light on the genesis and how this all came about slightly. Regardless of the letter, which I know there's discrepancies on both sides, I don't really want to get into that anymore. Like, that's been said and done. Stephen Lobo is a man of color. He's Middle Eastern and Portuguese, I believe. He was in an acting class, always looking for material to work on, because what parts are for Middle Easterns or Portuguese? /Portuguese guys. He's a man of color. He came across a play called Motherfucker with a Hat. So somebody said, hey, you should do this play. He went out and got the rights. This was about 2 years ago, to be quite honest. And he carried it around in his back pocket for at least over a year. And walked around with it and read it with an acting teacher and then read it with a couple of other people. And he read it around town. He had different casts and people, and he wasn't sure what he wanted to do with it. I think he was, trying to find who did he want to work with in this project. He then found Lori Triolo, which I think everybody knows. Lori Triolo would love to be here, but she's doing a cold reading series tonight. And they got together. And they went out and they started trying to find some cast, and how many Latinos they approached or didn't approach, that's been a big scrap that's happened, so I'm not even gonna go there. There was an offer that happened to a particular actor who was Latino in Toronto, and then he couldn't do it. It was obvious, though, that this was going to be a co-op. They were thinking about, let's go do this in some small black box, so on and so forth. You know, Lori can speak for herself, but she went out and did the search that she felt was comparable to having a search for looking for particular roles of Latino. Brian Markinson is the director. He came on board. People started getting excited. Okay, now we have a director. So now it's like, okay, really great. They called me, asked me if I wanted to play the role of Ralph. Ralph is a multi-ethnic role. You can be anybody, basically, to play Ralph. I read the play. I know these actors. I was hungry to do another play. So I said yes. Then as we started to get more momentum and excitement and falling in love with the play, different Veronicas came in and out, we read it different times at different people's houses, and we just started to get more and more enthusiastic, and we said, hey, what if we go to the arts club and read it for them? Do you think they would want to put this up? It's a little bit risky. It's called The Motherfucker with the Hat. But, you know, who knows, right? I mean, maybe Bill Miller will lose his mind and say yes. We had heard that we obviously have been hit with a perfect storm here, right? Like, we got, like, totally, this is the tipping point, this is something going on, right? Because one of my good friends in Toronto won a Dora Award for playing Jackie, and he's an Italian-Canadian. And I didn't hear any blowback, right? I know that there was a production in Calgary with Carmen, with the lead actor Jackie playing, he was Middle Eastern, and like, we just didn't hear of this blowback. So I think it wasn't in our psyche as much as it should be, as much as it obviously will be from now on. As much as there is an understanding that is starting to obviously come to light, which is why I'm really here, to be quite honest, because I get cast ethnically, or I don't get cast at all usually, so I play different roles, and I have played different roles, and I have played Latinos on television and film, and if I don't, I don't have a career. So we get together, and we go read it for the Arts Club, and they really liked the reading. We heard that Carmen had approached the Arts Club at one time to do a production of it as well. We heard that, so we weren't sure that they would bite, but they bit. Maybe because we have a little bit of television cue, because some of us are on TV, film, I don't know, maybe it's business. So we showed up and we read, and we thought we did a damn good reading, but they passed. And then we went to Ron Reed at Pacific, and he really wanted to do it, but his theater is below a church, and it's called The Motherfucker with the Hat. So he wasn't sure that he could swing it. So we started going around, and then we went to the fire hall, and we read it for Donna, and Donna being, you know, the beautiful woman that she is, and someone who, you know, would love to be here too, as you know, she's out of town. She started to show some interest, and we started getting excited, because we were like, oh my God, right? Like, maybe we'll start a theater company. Maybe this will be sort of like something we'll do, and we'll bring in all these actors, and we'll bring in all these people that want to work. But then we heard some stuff about, some stuff was starting to circulate about no Latinos and so on and so forth. And at that time, there was no Latinos in the cast, no official, no. So they held generals and they did a bunch of stuff like that, because it was far away enough that we all have television and film careers that we kind of knew that this was going to be a mercurial process. We didn't know when it was going to open, when it was going to get done, all of that. Slowly it started becoming more and more real. People were dropping out. Some guy got a job, moved to Toronto to do a TV series. I think Alessandro Giuliani came in for a minute. He left. But like, we were circulating this around, and as we started to move forward, we started to hear that there was a tremendous amount of unhappiness in the community. And our lead actress, who we love, Kira Zagorski, it became a big problem. And our company was about to fall apart. Our company fell apart, and she bailed out of the part. And she said, go and find a little So, and I realize that there are going to be people in this room that think I'm full of shit, and that's okay. I can only tell the story that we have, and the story has been the same, and it's not going to change, because it's our truth. She legitimately left. It was a big fight. There was a lot of tears because people felt that they had done their due diligence. Lori Triolo feels that she had done her due diligence. So that happened. Was the casting imperfect? Yes. Was it chronological? No. Was it unorthodox? Yes. I mean, we were a co-op with a thing in a back pocket. You know, we kind of didn't do the right fucking things to a certain degree in order for it to be properly executed. But she left, and there was a casting held. And I know Carmen read, I believe Allison read. And, you know, people think that casting was full of shit. People think that that was a bullshit casting, that no way were they going to replace. And it's not true, because I'll be honest, at the time, there was some stuff going on, and we were upset with each other, and we didn't like you very much at that moment. You know? We didn't. But we sat around, and we said, what if Carmen comes in and she's the one for you guys? Like, because I wasn't involved in the casting, because the director and the guy who had the rights was doing that, so I wasn't. And we sat around, we go, then we just do it. We just cast through and we go, and we move forward, and we go, God bless, it happened. So I sat by my phone, and they had their casting session, and listen, I'm an actor, man. If I got every part that I ever read for, I wouldn't be here. you know, I mean, it happens, right? I mean, like, so I'm waiting for the call, and they said, you know, and I don't want to put a lot of pressure now on Kira having to be Meryl Streep starting Saturday, but they said, we're fucked, because, my son's here and I'm swearing a lot, but I am doing a play called, and I said, what do you mean? And they said, it's Kira, it's got to be Kira, it doesn't work otherwise, it's whatever the reasons are. Every production is different. I know Carmen did a production of it and won an award, like, I get that. It's like, it's the chemistry, it's the combo, it's the whole thing, whatever it is. I wasn't part of the creativeness of that, I just was getting the word back. So we begged her to come back. She's going through a personal crisis right now in her family. I don't want to be irresponsible and maybe talk too much about it, but it was very difficult. That's why she's not here. She had to fly out of town. And then we went into rehearsal. And then the letter came out. And while we were in rehearsal, the letter came out, and the letter said that we were all white, which we weren't. Well, at that time, Francisco got on board. It was an imperfect situation. And I'm a little bit floored by it all. I think we all are. I think I'm here because I really, really honestly want to know where this new line of demarcation is. Like, I want to know, am I allowed to play A, B, and C? Or, I mean, I'm in rehearsal every day, and I'm looking at a poster of Mambo Italiano starring Francisco Trujillo. So, like, is that going to happen anymore or not? Am I right now just talking like some dumb white guy that doesn't know what the fuck's going on?
As one dumb white guy to another.
Yeah. So that's why I'm here. That's kind of the genesis. Yeah. Thank you for your time.
Yeah. No, and I think it's a great segue, because I think it might be beyond us to think that we're going to get to any quite so clear answers, but I think that should be the tenor of the conversation, is to try to, like you say, something is in the air. And just before I go on, there's a couple of things. First of all, that microphone is for the webcast, so you do not have to step up to the microphone. Anybody else is so inspired. If anybody really doesn't want to be seen on the webcast, they should make their way over to this side of the room. I tried to do that before we started, but there has been people trickling in, so I just wanted to say that. You're sort of implied your consent if you're kind of over on this side.
Or come over here if you really want to be on camera.
And so I think it's a really great segue into what I'm hoping will be a fruitful kind of forum discussion that's moving on from the details. We've heard sort of the accounts, anybody who's been following the various, some really smart and interesting and sometimes at odds and even acrimonious discussion and debate around the issue. We won't necessarily rehash all of those things unless they come up as part of the, you know, part of the discussion. I hope that it will all be sort of fruitful and sort of a more elevated discussion. And just before we start that, and just to lay down a few kind of notions around the tenor of the discussion, some of you may be asking, you know, who is this guy? You know, why is he here? And why am I moderating this? And I'll answer that in reverse order. I'm here because Carmen asked me. I have no, you know, right to be moderating this, but I do have some experience. I'm here also because Pedro is someone I respect, a colleague and a friend. I'm also here because I'm part of an interracial marriage, and I have children of mixed heritage, and as such have a personal stake in the future of this discussion. I recognize that you know, some may hold a utopian version of the future where we have all homogenized to the point where this discussion is is moot, but we don't live in that state right now in this time in history. And like you were mentioning, it is in the air. I mean, there's some examples that have already been mentioned that I wasn't aware of, but there was an issue around Aboriginal appropriation at the art gallery recently. There was the unplugging in Toronto, which was a source of a lot of controversy. And I wanted to echo what Carmen said, that I think it's really important that we're having this discussion now, because we have had discussions recently in relation to the Jessies, for instance, and while those are very important discussions, they tend to remain in the realm of the sort of the general and the academic, and sometimes that can, certain things can get lost. While important discussions can happen there, I think it's also important to acknowledge that this was precipitated by a specific event, that it is specifically around the Latino community and the Latino experience, which is different than the Aboriginal experience, than the African-Canadian experience. It has its own nuances. And so while I don't think anybody should be limited to using examples from other areas, I think it also is worth mentioning that we should acknowledge what precipitated this event and spend the bulk of our time talking about that. As such, I think it's good that we all recognize our own privilege and heritage in this room. This is a place to speak, but it is also a place to listen. I say that particularly to my white friends in the room. When I was talking to Carmen, when she asked me to do this, at which point I thought this was going to be like 12 people around the table in my studio. So we'll talk about that later. You know, she mentioned that there's likely enough argument within the Latino community around what defines a Latino for other folks to be chiming in and giving their view on the matter. So just that is just as an example of, you know, take the time to listen and don't always jump up to speak until you maybe just take that moment to sort of say, well, should I let somebody else talk or is this my place? I don't think I was going to go over a brief and very cursory recount of what had happened on sort of the most kind of mundane level of it. I think that's already happened. I don't think that we need to do that. I have here with me a series of questions that's been compiled from Facebook, from people who have called Carmen, from the different discussion groups, and I will refer to that if I have to. We're also following a Twitter feed, so if there's questions that come up along the way, we can chime those in. I have a feeling that we won't want for questions. But I'd like to kick it off with my own stupid question. I guess it should be a place that's hopefully safe, that people can feel like there are no stupid questions.
We'll see.
But I'll ask my own, you know, stupid question because, you know, I realized while we were sitting around the sushi joint up the way that I don't think that I was entirely certain as to what defined a Latino. And so maybe I'll ask Carmen and then open up to the floor to both questions and answers and discussion as to what defines a Latino. Is it a race? Is it an ethnicity? Is it, what is it?
Yes. And just to add to what you said before, I would also like to ask the men in the room, regardless of your color, to let the women speak. That would be really nice. What is a Latino? Well, it depends who you ask. And again, let's only have the Latinos say what they think a Latino is. It is not a race. It is an ethnicity and it is a culture. So Latinos come in all races. There are Latinos who are literally like the Aryan nation, blonde, blue eyes, and as dark as, my sweater and everything in between. So it is not a race, it is an ethnicity. What we've been hearing a lot on Facebook and all over from all kinds of people is, but why is it a problem that the motherfucker with the hat, the original cast that is pre-Francisco, doesn't have any Latinos, because Latinos is not a race, so anybody can play them. And that is a really, really good question. So even though we are not a race, we are an ethnic minority, and we do get erased all the time. We are invisible on stage and on screen, precisely because it is very hard to define who we are. The latest equity findings, I think somebody in equity can probably correct me, is that I think 29% of roles on Canadian stages are played by women. A lot of those roles don't even have speaking parts. Of those roles, 3.7% are played by women of color. If you now try and get specific as to how many Latina women of color get roles, I think you know where I'm going with this. So one of the reasons it was upsetting for us is that, for example, the Latina lead in this play, which almost never happens, is being played by a white woman. That is an issue for us, for the reasons that I just explained. In terms of Latinos being a race, I know for myself that sometimes I refer to us as the Latino race. Where do I get that from? I get that from the Chicano Nation, which is in California, and I personally have a strong connection with Chicanos, and Chicanos refer to themselves as la raza, which means the race. And it has to do with Chicano pride, and the mix of blood that Chicanos are is something that I can identify with as a person who I myself am of mixed heritage, that is to say indigenous and Spanish, which is what Chicanos are. And because I am a proud Latina, I do use that Latina race or Viva la Raza language, even though it's not a race. So women first, please. If anybody else wants to say what a Latina is, or if they want to completely disagree with me and say, you're full of shit, I think that would be great.
I think Alison and Rhea, introduce myself briefly, and very excited to see so many faces and participants in this conversation. Latina, Hispanic, Spanish get confused a lot in popular media and in popular culture. Oftentimes, for example, a pet peeve of mine is Taco Bell commercials with flamenco dancers mixing cultures, and this is okay, and it's not, because it's culturally inappropriate and it's missing specificity. So I am born in Australia. My parents are Chilean. I lived in Italy for 5 years and I've been here for 10 years. I consider myself international, but I am Latina. That's my accent.
And I'll try to keep a running order of who's talking, so I'll keep scanning around, and if I catch your eye, right. Don't catch your eye, keep trying. I think you had your hand up there.
I did.
Okay. So you first and then back.
I am not in any way competent to comment on who does or does not qualify on being Latina or Latino. What I would like to comment on, if that's okay with you, Jay, is the invisible, to me, issue in the room that Carmen has touched on, which is we're talking about jobs. And this is where things always become divisive. Anyone who knows me knows that my file, my cause is gender equality, and any time that I look at an issue, I look at it through the lens of gender equality. To go back to the question of how do we move forward, I would like to point out that, in my opinion, the argument that has been flowing on Facebook has unfairly pinpointed Carmen as a target. And I was quite astonished to find out that, in fact, Pedro is the person who said, we have to say something. So this, to me, is part of the problem. I realize that this issue has been raised of an entire community who is not seen, is not considered for jobs, but this, to me, is very, very unfortunate. I have stayed out of the fray because I have enormous respect for everyone who is involved with this project, either raising the consciousness of the community and that things were not done as inclusively as they might have been, or artists who have fallen in love with the play and want to struggle to bring it to life and bring it to a city that desperately needs it. I do feel honor-bound to point this out and to say, I stand with my sister Carmen. She has done nothing other than raise an issue with a community that needs to be raised. And I will not stand by and hear her demonized in any way, shape, or form.
Latina actress and understanding the nuance of your question. For me, cultural specificity and a blood memory or access to a certain culture is an important part of beginning that work, which, being Latina, I am culturally aware enough of the differences between an Argentinian culture, the Chilean culture, Peruvian culture, and so if it is my job to interpret a woman of any of those countries, I have an accessibility in terms of what Stella Adler would call blood memory. So there is my end. If we start drawing lines specifically about because I'm not of that origin, I'm not of that culture, we would all be very limited into the work that we could do. And it would take away a big part of what it is to be an actor and to be an artist. So that's that. You know, that's the best answer I can offer you in that. And I would never want an artistic world where we can only play what we are, or else, you know, that sort of defeats the purpose.
If I can offer up a statement from somebody who's not in the room, which is Hiro Kanagawa, that pertains to this, which was interesting, is that we seem to have a fairly well-defined idea of that blackface is not okay, that yellowface is not okay. And it's interesting that we, when it comes to Latino culture, that seems less clear.
Yeah.
And I don't know where the line, I don't know where the line is, but somehow, probably through discussions like this, we found our way to that, perhaps, I don't know. So I'm gonna go over to here.
Well, I just wanna say one quick thing to answer. I would start, if it was, if we are talking about the motherfucker with the hat, so let's talk about that for just a second. I would start by auditioning people who identify as Latino, as opposed to, if I'm not Latino, trying to myself figure out who's Latino, or me going, oh, well, that person's Latino and that person's not Latino. Who am I to say that? I would just put the call out and say, I'm looking for Latinos, and the people who show up clearly identify as Latino, so I am going to believe them. And I will seek those people out, whatever it takes. For many reasons, many of which have to do with what Christine had to say, right? Already, only 3.7% of women of color are on Canadian stages. Almost none of them are Latina, so why not give these people a chance and let them identify whether they're Latino or not? Yeah.
Yeah, I just wanted to add that I saw the letter that was sent to Haberdashery because it was on Facebook, and he used the word vitriol, and I thought it was a very respectful letter. I thought it was had no anger in it. I thought it had a simple question for the company, which was, we would like to know where in the casting process were Latinos called. And if you weren't able to find them, then I think this is part of the discussion here, would be what can we facilitate within the artist community so artists of color know when there are auditions, and producers and directors know where to go so they can get a hold of them, because there are so few roles available.
And David,
and even more for women, like just one Latina woman in that play.
Yeah.
So I think that's sort of where we want to go. So if Haberdashery didn't have the tools to go, wow, we need to look at Latinos, and they didn't know where to go, this is where we want to go, because Latinos, I did another polemic play, which was in the Arts Club, which was in the Heights, another Latino base. Then again, I was the only Latino, so that's hard to get in trouble. And there was a wonderful Filipino dancer who was incredibly talented as a dancer and a singer, and he had just given up going to auditions. He said, I've given up. He said, I go to auditions, I get to the third and the fourth audition, and they just said, oh, we just found somebody different. And he knew what he was hearing. So he had given up even showing, he didn't even go to the audition of the Arts Club for that show. So people of color end up giving up going to auditions. So we need to here find a way that the people who are out there and who have given up can be accessed and reached. So I think this is part of the discussion, is how do the invisible become visible and known and have the opportunity? But I didn't think the letter had vitriol at all. I thought it was just sort of asking for an explanation. And I think, you know, you said, you know, that the process was we started small as an established theater company, not even knowing whether we were gonna have a backing or do it in a basement or in a church. So I think there was not a sort of the regular process of casting, but there were some issues, which is what we're discussing here. But I think it's about looking how to have those tools.
So I'm sorry, I don't know your name, but
Patrick Spongy, an actor. So the question was relating to appropriateness of the casting. You mentioned that one of the main issues is that the actress who has been cast is white. And I find it interesting that we're having a discussion about the nebulous definition of Latina or Latino, and how that category encompasses a lot of different races. So I kind of extend that question to that actress's whiteness. Do you know what her ethnic heritage is? When we say white, is that, is there
no I know that she's not Latina, because I've asked that question many, many times before we even wrote the letter. And when I first started having the conversation with Stephen Lobo in June, but he phoned me to talk about something else entirely, and that's when we ended up talking about this, and that's when he told me that the entire play was cast, and I asked him directly, are there any Latinos in the play? And he said no. And I've asked that question more than once just to make absolutely sure that, you know, the information is correct, precisely for that reason, because the woman might be white, but she might be Latina, so I don't know. That's why I asked the question, right? And I was told that she is not. Otherwise, we would not have written the letter.
Okay, but we don't know specifically. So the second part of my question is, when we're talking about appropriateness of casting, one issue that's really hard to define is, you know, the castability or how an individual presents, right? Because regardless of your ethnic heritage, the world is going to see you and place you in the category either Caucasian or non-Caucasian. And I can say with confidence that the woman in question doesn't present 100% of the time to the world around her as strictly Caucasian. So is the question mark of her ethnicity, does that disqualify her from playing anything related to any ethnicity other than white, even though she doesn't present that? And I face that question all the time as an actor of color, or not, depending on your perspective.
Thank you for your comments. I think that, and this is just a question that came on through Twitter, and I think that, I'm not sure if this was your meaning, but I do think that white folk do need to look at possibly their ancestry as part of the way of understanding their privilege. And that was sort of the notion of the Twitter thing too, right? It's because it's not like white folk lack culture, and anyway, so that was sort of a comment that came through on Twitter there.
Does that privilege come from the ethnic lineage, or does it come from a lot from how you present to the world and how people see?
Well, I think the other issue you're bringing up that other people might want to talk about is, and I think this is a very big difference between the film world and the theater world, is this notion of passing. So-and-so can pass for such-and-such, and so-and-so can't pass for such-and-such, regardless of their true ethnicity. So, I mean, I think they're big issues, they're complex. And maybe I'll see, I don't know if Omari, if you had, were you next, you were next, if you wanted to comment on that or something different.
Well, I did have comments, but I want to respect what each one in the room, my comments weren't as well, so someone else who wants to add, I'll see and I'll speak with you.
Okay.
I don't know if I'll address this comments right away, but my name is Carmen Rodriguez. I'm a Chilean-Canadian writer. I came to Canada 40-something years ago as a refugee. And to me, as a writer and also as an educator, as a Latina, the issue comes down to power. And if we look at our society today in Canada, we cannot say other than this is a society where white people, men, hold the balance of power. So it is power that allows certain groups to be visible or invisible. And it's up to those groups, those minority groups that do not hold the balance of power, to fight for achieving at least a little bit of that power. I also like the word revolution a lot, like the other card. So we need to revolutionize the society by making our space and by making our demands heard. If there is a play that has three roles that are for Latinos, it doesn't fit in my mind that somebody, producer, enthusiast, who fell in love with the play, wouldn't go, oh, there are three roles for Latinos. Let's see, you know, maybe there are three Latinos that can play this role. Wow, wouldn't that be novel, you know? But why doesn't that person ask himself that question? Because he doesn't have to. He has a lot of power. He can play himself, he can play somebody else who is not Latino, he can, and the question doesn't even come up. The question doesn't even cross his mind. So it is our role as Latinos, and from any other minority that is here in this country, to bring up that question and to bring up the issue and to fight for those spaces that we don't have and that we have been making for ourselves, in our case, over 40 years. It has taken over 40 years for the Latino community to start getting a presence in this country. We Chileans were the first community from Latin America to arrive in big numbers here in Canada. We kind of opened the way to others. We have Colombians, we have Cubans, we have Mexicans, we have people from all over Latin America now, artists, writers of all kinds. You ask any of us, has it been easy? Oh, he's okay, right? No, it has not been easy. It has been hard to forge your way in a country which is dominated by a certain ethnicity, by a certain class, by a certain gender. It's not easy to make your way. So that's why Carmen Aguirre, for example, has created her own place, because she couldn't find a play where she could see herself represented, right? So we have to create our own work, because otherwise we're not there, we're invisible. And we have to wait nicely, right? Oh, let's wait and see if this white man is going to offer me, right, a little space in his project. Oh, he didn't see me. Oh, too bad, right? No, it's about time that we turn things around and that we start demanding our place. Because we have a place, and we have the talent, we have the education, we have the training, we have the wherewithal to be seen and to be heard. So, having said that, become founding members of the Vancouver Latin American Cultural Center.
So I'm going to let Carmen answer Patrick's question, and then we're going to go Omari, David, Amelia, Mindy.
Okay. So first of all, I'm super lucky because the lady who just spoke happens to be my mother. So I'm very lucky to have that woman. That woman raised me. All right. So to answer your question, the trend right now in 2016, maybe I'm being too, you know, wishful thinking here. The trend in 2016 is that when there is a role written for an ethnic minority, you will go to the actors of that ethnicity first. That is what you will do. We believe very strongly that if the motherfucker with the hat I'm talking about Vancouver. Maybe somebody, somewhere else that wouldn't happen, okay? If the motherfucker with the hat had three black characters, they would have gone out of their way to find three black actors. If it had three Asian characters, it would have gone out of their way to find Asian actors. Same with First Nation. Even if they didn't believe in that, they would have gone out of their way because they know there would have been a bit of a problem. People would have spoken out, right? So that's what we're talking about as Latinos, that we are so invisible that it's okay for people who are not Latinos to play us. And then to get very upset when we say, hey, you guys, it would have been nice to have been seriously considered. And I'm just going to keep going back to what I said before in terms of percentages. The fact that only 3.7% of women of color are on stage right now, when there is an opportunity to play a romantic lead for a Latina, right now where we are, 2016, you start by looking for a Latina. That's where you start. In my case, I would then go to, okay, what's the next step? A woman of color. Can't find a Latina, there are none in Vancouver, I don't have money to fly one in. Okay, I'll go with a woman of color before I go with a white woman. It has nothing to do with how good she is, the white woman. She might be Meryl Streep. We're not talking about how good this white woman is. It is a given that she's good, otherwise she wouldn't be in the play. Those are all great actors. We all believe they're great actors. So that is my belief. We are not in a post-racial society in which we are all equal. If that exists, please tell me, because I will move there right now. But right now, we are not. That is why when it's culturally specific, especially when it's a minority, an ethnic minority, that's where you begin to cast, and you go out of your way to find those people. You don't just go, hey, you guys, I'm looking for somebody. You go out of your way, like David C. Jones did with Heather's musical. He wanted 52% people of color, and he went out of his way to find those people. Why? Because this Filipino actor that Francisco was talking about, if he had seen the call for Heather's the musical, he would have said, I'm never going to get fucking cast in that thing, so I'm not even going to bother anymore. That's why David said, no, everybody, I actually want 52% to be people of color. And he went out of his way, and he got 181 amazing auditions from people of color. But he did his job. He went out and looked for those people. So that is my answer.
Well, first off, Carver, didn't you know that America is post-racial because Obama won, so grace is So, Omari Newton, I'm an actor, and I guess I'm a de facto activist community. One of the members of Real Canadian Theatre that spearheaded the movement to speak with the Jessies about what we felt was systemic exclusion. And just, first, to just give props to the community, because I don't know how many of you guys know what the updates on that are, but myself and Valerie and Kristen Shelley, who co-authored the letter, are now all board members of the Jessies. Valerie and I are board, so props to the community for sincerely stepping up and it gives me confidence we can make a difference tonight. Now, I just wanted to put something in the room here. I didn't sign the letter from the Latino community. But not because I'm not philosophically down with the cause, which I absolutely am. I just had some structural questions about this specific case and the nature of this production. And I'll put it out in the room here. Maybe someone can ask this to me. I feel like there's been issues being conflated here, where the genesis of this production, from what I understand, was a co-op, right? A co-op, by definition, and stop me if I'm wrong, is a group of artists coming together and saying, we, these people forming this group, want to put on this piece. That is fundamentally different from a company like the Arts Club that's receiving federal funding through Canada Council, getting the rights to a play and putting the call out to have the best people come in for it. Right? Now, I'm not saying that a co-op doesn't have the same moral obligation to fulfill a certain amount of diversity in casting. And I'm not saying that if I saw a production go up and I wasn't down with the way the show was cast, I would support them. But I think it is a different thing. And one of my major issues from the beginning was I just didn't understand why this wasn't being discussed, that this wasn't, you know, the man, you know, speaking in the capital TM, getting the rights to something with tons of funding going, we're excluding people getting this. this, the genesis was a group of actors getting together and saying, we want to put on this play. So I just want to put that out there and ask, where you guys stand on?
Certainly, as a letter writer in this, it's even that question you're asking. We as a group of friends decided to put on a play that had three Latino characters and none of us are Latino. None of us are Latino in this room, but we feel we can play Latinos. That's where I was like, okay, even if it is a co-op.
I want to jump in on that for a second. There's also been the issue of brown face that's been brought up, which is obviously horrible and wrong, right? But to quote the playwright himself, he has said, ideally, it should be Latinos in the role.
No, he says Puerto Rican.
He said Puerto Rican. Yeah. Fine. So he said, ideally, there should be Puerto Ricans in the role. I would extend that to Latino. And of course, I agree. And personally, I would never cast a play with real Latinos, with anything but Latinos, myself personally. But the playwright did say, if you cannot do that, it is okay to have a white cast if you do not do brown face. Right? And I didn't understand why that hasn't been talked about until we see the rehearsal. If we don't see someone doing a very broad offensive stereotype, the playwright himself has said the ideal would be having Latinos, but it's okay so long as you're not disrespecting the culture.
Yeah, and we never questioned the fact that they were going to do brown face or that they were going to appropriate our culture and play Latinos on stage. It was the fact that in a play where there are three Latino characters, there were no Latinos brought in.
Yes.
That's from us.
Yeah. Which is absolutely an issue. Yeah. But I will say, by the time this issue was brought to me, there was Latinos in the play. And I felt like when it went public, that wasn't mentioned. Mm-hmm. Which is one of the reasons why I felt like I couldn't.
It was in the letter that there was a Latino in the cast.
I misspoke that, I apologize. But I just felt like we have people who are allies who fucked up. Undeniably, we have allies who fucked up, who formed this company. But we have allies that acknowledge the fact they fucked up, and we're actively working towards remedying this massive fuck up in what I felt was a real way. And to let my own personal, I sat with the actress in question when she broke down and dropped out of the play. I know this was a real thing. So the only thing I'm asking is, how do we as a community, all of us, I'm not just saying anyone else, how do we work towards constructive solutions that include people who are trying, truly trying their best, but fucked up, without it becoming this adversarial thing, which I felt like it kind of became in social media and other corners?
Mm-hmm. I just have a little question.
Yeah, well, I just want to finish the answer.
The genesis was a co-op, but it is a Fire Hall production.
I'm trying not to speak.
I'm sensing the hostility to start to rise.
I don't have hostility.
No hostility.
I promise you there's
okay.
no hostility. I've just
no
given
hostility.
A fact. We are donating, we have to, give all of our pay back to the production in order to be able to do the play. And we had to go on Indiegogo, as you know, to raise money for the play. And to raise money for a recovery house, because we believe one of the larger themes of the play is addiction, which everybody, if you know the play, it's about addiction. So we're donating some of the money to the recovery house. So it's still co-op-y in the sense of that we have, she's presenting us, God bless her, but we are paying, I won't give you the numbers, but more than we have. So we're all having to give our paycheck.
And just before I'm going to give Carmen a chance to speak, but I just want to say, you said a lot of things there, Maria, and I just want to sort of break them out. I'm hearing a couple different things. One is the intention of the playwright. I agree that's something that's interesting to discuss. And I think what Pedro's bringing up is also that there also is the standards of our community. And those are two different things. Sometimes they align, sometimes they don't. And so I just wanted to say, just so you brought up the idea of conflating, so just the idea of separating out the issues for those that would like to discuss them further. Carmen,
yes.
Would like to speak, and then then we're going to go to David. He's been waiting very patiently for a long time.
Okay. Can I be on the list?
We're working our way around, and you are on the list after David.
There's a lady back here with blue ringlets
who's been trying this for a while.
Okay.
That's you. Yeah. And I use that name intentionally because I'm here in my spirit flesh and not in my meat suit. In my meat suit, I work in the area of culture as a bureaucrat. And I work in the area of culture as a bureaucrat because as who I am at heart and as spirit for the last 25 years is a performer. I'm an artist. And I got out, I stopped acting because I couldn't work. I couldn't even work in Vancouver. I did lots of work back when there was awareness of black people in film and TV in the early 2000s. I don't work anymore. So, you know, Vancouver's an expensive place. I don't perform anymore. And now because of my job, I can't perform on a theater stage because a lot of the people in this room are my clients. Having said that, I would like to suggest that when I talk about, I increasingly do not talk about white people because it's tricky. I do talk about people who appear to be of European descent. I think that's really critical when an audience member who is unsophisticated, who doesn't know the details, the back and forth behind the scenes, casting of stage, film, or TV, and they, me, when I'm sitting at home next Netflixing, you know, I see people who appear to be of European descent. And when I see brown faces in whatever spectrum, I identify them as not being of European descent. That doesn't mean that they aren't, right? There's lots of African descent people in England, for example. I think it is important when, even in the case of a co-op, that be kept in mind. I think I understand the, having done lots of co-ops early in my career, I understand and I appreciate what it is to be passionate about a work and want to produce it. And going back to what Carmen has said, 3.7% of people on stage are women of color. Like, I don't work. So if a play is selected that has an opportunity for a person of color, and the people who are selecting are or will be interpreted by the audience, more than likely, come on, we're all smart people, like we can split the scintillas, but come on, as people that are of European descent, I think there's a kind of fraud going on. These kinds of conversations for me have been happening since I was a teenager 15 and getting into theater. This exact conversation, like this isn't new, it's tired. I don't actually understand why it's a thing. I actually don't. There's actually a piece of my brain missing about it. So I get what you're saying, Omari, but I find it difficult to give a pass. People that appear to be of European descent are the majority persons that create and interpret culture worldwide. Mm-hmm. And I think it is really important when there are opportunities for people of color to be involved, that they are involved in whatever way.
I of course agree with that. I'm not saying that they should.
And I'm saying, like in terms of like, so even in the case of this production, which was originated as a co-op, there's an instance of From the Mountaintop, which is about Martin Luther King, that stars a white man as a person of European descent as MLK. Now, you know, if a co-op decided it's an amazing script, but if a co-op of people who appear to be of European descent did the same thing, I don't care that they're a co-op, they're still not going to get cast just because they're a co-op.
I agree.
And so I'm not convinced that there isn't still a kind of obligation. And as artists, if what we do is interpret the world around us, then I think we've got some moral obligation to reflect it in some ways. The people that hold the power that are the arts club, for example, or the fire hall, or people who have the opportunity to make the key decisions, they have a higher burden. And we who come together to tell stories, we have another burden. Because otherwise, what are we doing? Like, what are we doing as artists? We're not reflecting the world. The world as it is not level.
If I can interject with a tweet from Camila Diaz Varela, I want to be a part of a theater community that holds members accountable and supports each other when we fuck up. You know, I think that kind of sums it up. And I'd also like to give just one shout out, because Sherry Yoon, my partner, is the woman who crunched the numbers to arrive at the 3.7%. So she's not here. She's not here because, whatever, we can't both get out of the house at the same time these days. And I also wanted to just say one thing. We're planning to go until 9 o'clock. Just, we still have lots of time, but I just, in the interest of everybody knowing that this will end. This too shall pass. There's a long list. Okay. David's been waiting for quite a while, so.
I got the whole solution. No, I don't. I originally raised my hand when Francisco was talking, but other things have come up that I think relate to it. This community isn't really one community, and it hasn't been since I was about 20. You know, there really are about 8 different communities in Vancouver. There's like a couple of film communities, and there's the people who do Bard and the Arts Club, and then there's, you know, 3 or 4 small theater communities, and blah, blah, blah. Some people overlap. But I think I was trying to parse this whole thing as the stuff was flying back and forth, and listening to gossip and et cetera, et cetera. And I was talking to one of my best friends, who's an Aboriginal playwright and actor, and I said, well, one of the things I'm hearing, gossip, is, well, they asked Carmen to suggest a bunch of people, and she only suggested herself. I have no idea if this is true or not, it doesn't matter to the story. My friend said, it's not her job. And she said, because for myself as an Aboriginal actor, I am constantly being asked who all the other Aboriginal actors are. I'm being asked to tell everybody who my competition is, et cetera, et cetera. And she basically said, fuck that. So I realized part of the problem is that none of us really know who all is out there. And she had also gone off a little bit about, at one point, when somebody from one of the... somebody from a company of color was talking about stuff, and she said, this person knows nothing about the Aboriginal actors in town, how can they claim to speak for actors of color? So when you realize how many different fractured, balkanized communities we have in this town, one of the problems is that how do you do exactly what Carmen said, which is certainly, if, you know, I personally wouldn't even know how to start with this particular play. I wouldn't produce it. I would just beg to be in it if it was a part of me. But if I was to do it, the first thing I would want to do is say, who are the actors who identify as Latino? And then the question is, where do I find them? And I have this really terrible thought that I feel kind of horrified to suggest, because it actually sounds kind of creepy. But maybe somebody can make it better, which is, I feel like we need a database that's accessible to anybody who's casting, which basically says, here are all the actors in town who identify as trans. Here are all the actors in town who self-identify as female. Here are all the actors in town who identify as black, but also West Indian, or whatever. So that when you're saying, I want to try to find somebody, my first thing I'm going to do is go to try to meet everybody who can authentically claim to speak for this community, and I do believe in the blood thing. I have, for the first time in my life, all my friends are constantly going to shows and going, why the fuck was that Chinese person being played by somebody that I know isn't Chinese? And for the first time in my life, I'm Jewish, I never get cast as Jews, once in my life. But I watched a show not long ago where I was actually horrified by a really fine actor playing a Jew, and it was just like, In a million years, I will not believe that guy's a Jew. And it was a show about identity, and I was just like, so I suddenly had the visceral first thing of saying, why the fuck was that very fine actor in that part? And I was horrified, I felt sick when I came out. So I don't ever want to put somebody in that position again. The number of times that I'm trying to think about who the actors are that I could think about for a project, and 2 months later, it would be, I'm just thinking, in terms of a practical starting place, so that people aren't making this mistake, and so that nobody has the excuse of saying, well, we couldn't find anybody, would be to say, is it possible that somebody might be the Arts Alliance or somebody might be willing to take this on as an actual thing. And is that a really stupid idea? Because if people think it's a stupid idea, I don't know.
It's a great idea.
Okay, so So Valerie's going to respond, and then I have Amelia, Mindy, David.
So David, you'll be pleased to know that my company, Visceral Visions, is developing a database. I've been working like even before the Jesse stuff. There was other things, and I said a database would solve all our problems. And I was the same thing. People were calling me and asking me to recommend people for their projects, and they would never ask me. So I said, if I'm going to do this work for free, I might as well like do the real thing, because I don't know everybody either, right? But I do want to say, it's hard work getting the funding. New World Theatre has, you know, when they found out I was doing it, they gave me some money. Hammer Foundation just gave me some money, but Camp Council just turned me down.
What?
Yeah. So it's going to be difficult. So I'm just trying to get the word out. If you know, have ideas about, or want to somehow partner, or, you know, find ways, because I think what the jury response was, oh, it's a great idea, but you're a small company and we don't believe that you can do it yourself. Why don't you get a bigger white organization to help you? and I am partnered with the GVPTA, but it's I very specifically wanted this to be of people of color, you know, actually having control and say about who they are, how they're going to be presented, how we educate people about when they come in and access that information. So that there isn't this kind of thing, well, he's brown, so he can play anything. You know, there needs to be an educational component to that database. I'm not just going to put it out and say, you know, go to it.
And it's also going to have, there's going to be ongoing money because you're going to have to maintain the people coming out of theater schools.
Yeah, I'm working with a digital media company who knows what they're doing and knows that, you know, we want it to be a self, we're working on a self-sustaining model. But, I mean, to build it, it's very expensive, right? So that answers your question.
So we all need to find ways to
support
this project.
I
you're going to do it in French and you might get appointed in the Catholic Council.
Also,
no,
I happen to
be in French. It's one of the funny things. If it's in French and English, if you get in an English part of the country, if it's in English and French, you jump to the top of the list. It's just the fact.
Right.
So,
okay.
Also, equity and inclusion is a big part of yeah, it's not that. It's not that simple. I'll just take PACT. I happen to be the president of a big white organization who just did a strategic plan on equity and inclusion being a priority.
Yes.
And I think it's and they're revamping their entire kind of digital portal as well. And I think we should talk. Yeah.
Great.
Amelia.
I just wanted to make a response or something to what, sorry, I forget your name in the back half, not Amari.
Patrick.
Yeah. But what you said about the line of identifying as white and passing. And I guess I just wanted to say I felt pretty affected by the comment in terms of that I know I'm white. I know the privilege that I was born with and taught. I know everything I saw on TV my whole life is white. And I know that it's my job to, and this is where it gets hard because I get so scared about language and stuff, but it's my job to step down and say, I want balance, I want equality.
No.
And so I'm not gonna take the job. And therefore, yeah, I need the job just as much. Current client makes more than me, whatever. I have power. I don't feel like I have power. But I do because I'm white, because I don't have that experience in my heart of knowing blood, heart. I don't. And you do. And so that's the difference. And that's what I'm trying to navigate as a
but in this case, the actress in question did do just that, step down because of that guilt. But also, she's not nearly as fair as you, and so she is not, I forgot how you put it, but she does not necessarily appear to be of European descent.
But she knows she's white. She knows she's white.
That's the question.
But
she
is white.
Step down.
Is she white? That's all you have to ask. Is she white? Is she European descent?
I thought that was the conversation, is that it's not that cut and dry. That's what we're trying to define.
But no. Is she of European descent? Is her mother and father...
She doesn't know her entire heritage. She might have some Northern Russian. She might have Mongolian in her, which is apparent in her feature. She has a lot of European. Her family's been in the United States for at least 5 generations, and they haven't kept tabs on where their ethnic lineage extends. She doesn't appear to be white. You see her on the street, that's not your first guess.
Right.
She's constantly asked, what is she?
Okay, so it's pretty complicated.
Can I just say one thing? I think the complication also arises with, and we don't have to talk about it now, but eventually sometime maybe getting there, and it might not be in this meeting actually, but what it is to be an actor, what it is to train as an actor, and to create range as an actor, and be able to play different roles as an actor, because that's something that I'm interested in understanding as well, as I move forward, and as we all, because I teach acting as well, and so people are coming out of acting school and wondering, what is the new, again, line of, I know you look this way, but and you're this, or you're white, or you're not white, or you're people, and you can play these roles, so where's the career part of it? I understand the social, political aspect of it, the morale, all of that, but we are talking about creating film and television and theater.
But we're not talking about looks.
Opportunities.
Why are we reducing the conversation?
But I think the characters of, say, this particular play also have to be. Oh, I'm sorry. Did I say something offensive?
No, it's not looks.
If we can bring it back to the order of the conversation, and also to acknowledge, I think one of the things that's been offered, I think in a number of different ways, including what Amelia just said, and the response is, it is hard for me to look and see where you came from, but I think that we do on some level, and that is complicated, and in the world of film, passing and those kinds of things is a very common way of talking about it. But I think there is something that is pretty cut and dry, which is that we do know in our hearts how we identify. You know, and I think that how we identify is kind of at the root of what I'm hearing from the Latino community is what they want respected. Is that, you know, passing is one thing, but why don't we start with people who identify? And I think that part of the solution, and I think what you're offering up, Amelia, that is pretty straightforward, is it's for some people maybe it's harder than others, but if each of us takes on the job of self-identifying, and that could be a multifaceted thing, and for some and for others it would be more straightforward, that's going to do some of the work, you know, and taking responsibility for that, and not just seeing what we can pass for. And I know it's tempting when it comes to casting and roles, and I'm not necessarily in the position where I have to go after roles, and I acknowledge that as more of a producer. But to keep the conversation moving forward in some sense of fairness, I think we have Mindy next, and then David C. Jones, and then I have Kamyar.
Yeah, I was way back earlier.
Well, no, there was a list that was even before. Before, believe me, I mean, this goes way back. And then Jane, I know that Jane Heyman also is on the list. So we'll go after Kamyar, and you're still on the list. And then, but that's the next three, but I am keeping a list, okay? And it does go back
so my
to Mindy.
My name is Mindy Carson. My question actually was very similar to Lamar's, which was, the question of a group of people coming together who are a co-op, who have cast the play amongst themselves, the difference between that and an organization that is funded by our province, by our city, by our nation. And I think that is also complicated in this particular case by... And I don't know all the details of it. I don't know when things were cast and not cast, all those nuances, which I think are important. I don't want to belittle them, but I is that I do think it's important when we're talking about a community that is has many different facets, and my understanding of this group, and again, I don't know, is that a lot of them come from a film background, and in a film background, that's not true.
We all come from a theater background as well, but I know what you're about to say, and that's
right,
a lot of film work, yes.
That there is a sense in the film world, I think, of playing different passing, and that, so I'm not saying, I don't want to say that, that makes it okay, that there wasn't a mistake made, and I think it's important to bring up the problem, I really do, and also I think it's important to have compassion in this situation, that people come with their own preconceived ideas and notions about what's okay and what's not okay, and that I'm constantly confronting that myself. I'm constantly what Amelia is saying. Like, where is my privilege? Where is that place? Where am I not privileged because I'm a mother and I'm trying to balance that part of my life? But where are all those lines? And it's so complicated. But I think, you know, also to speak with what Omari said is, how do we have these conversations in a way where we appreciate when people are making an effort, and when we see our own blind spots, we all have blind spots, right? We all have blind spots. So how do we see those and go, yeah, fuck, that's my blind spot. That's totally, like, I don't really get that. And now I need to get that. And then as the other person on the other side of that go, great, that's, you know, and we need to talk more about it, and we need to understand it more. But I guess I feel like I just want to encourage all myself to do that, because I'm not always good at that either. Sometimes I can be here, fuck.
So since my name was Boca, can I briefly elaborate?
Briefly. Just acknowledging that there's not a ton of time left, and I still like to try to get to
a wide variety of voices.
A wider variety of voices would be good.
That's okay. I don't even have to speak, but just because you all have a vote. That's okay.
I'm done.
Tamia, you're up.
No, I think someone else.
David C. Jones, and then Tamia.
Okay, so two things really quick. This is one of the things that I discovered when we were producing our show. So the information I got was told to me by someone at the equity offices, so I believe them to not be crazy. Because what I did is I called, because I've done equity co-ops before, and I went, hi, I'm thinking of doing this mega musical. I want to do it as an equity co-op. What do we do? How does it work? And what I was told is equity co-ops don't exist anymore as they were in the past. They're now called artistic collectives. And I said, what does that mean, an artistic collective? And they went, it means that artists have put together a show. Does that mean I have to find all the artists, or can I hold auditions? It's no longer a co-op where it has to be all people who come together. An artistic collective can actually hold auditions. And I went, okay, I just want to be super clear. I don't want to fuck anything up. And I do an artist collective where everyone is a like-minded person coming together on this project, but I could actually audition people. And because in the co-op model, you couldn't do that. And I went, no, that is what you can do. And I went, okay, you sure? And I went, yes. I went, okay, that's when the audition notice went out saying we're doing a which is the new term for co-ops. We're doing an artistic collective, and I had to put in brackets equity co-op, because that's what they used to be called, right? And that's how we did our audition. And so it isn't a co-op artistic collective, art production. So that's, I think, a different thing, because if people think of co-ops the way they used to be, I'm pretty positive, unless this person on the phone was crazy, that Edward would say, yeah, they don't kind of exist like that anymore. The other quick little thing I'll say really fast, I'm shaking like fuck right now, sorry. and I'm trying to talk really fast. One of the things that I've talked, because I'm good friends with Valerie when I was an elected advisor, that's when I'll be read about that shit. But one of the things, we've got to stop saying open to all ethnicities on our audition calls, because no one believes it. Right? So when you're doing an audition call, be really, like in movie calls, they'll say person of color for this role. Yeah. And if you're doing a glass menagerie and you go open to all ethnicities, no one's going to believe you. But if you put Amanda, person of color, you're going to have a lineup down the block. Now people going, really? I can really play Amanda? Yeah, fuck, I'll audition for that. You're like, unlike you said, I want a person to play that part. you won't have a problem with people not showing up for the audition. You'll have a huge crowd of people showing up.
Thank you for those practices. We have a rebuttal over here. I think at this point we're going to. Sorry, we have a rebuttal over here. Well, I think.
Oh yeah,
I think we're going to move on to caviar because I mean those are two interesting pieces of information that they weren't particularly contentious, and so if we do need to, that makes sense. I think that.
If there's time after.
Yeah, we'll get around. We'll get around. Yeah.
Anyway, I sympathize, Barrett. I'm sweating like an athlete. My name is Kamyar. Full disclosure, I'm here sitting between Carmen and John because when it comes to, like Christine so eloquently did, defending Carmen's right to be the remarkable activist that she is, I'll put my neck on the line anytime. At the same time, John reached out to me, and I think the fact that this man came with his son and showed so much heart by being here is also very admirable and worthy of mention. So some might call me a fence sitter. I like to think of myself as a bridge builder, and no one's done it better than these guys who have just actually showed up. And I think in some ways it makes the actual details of the letter and what Haberdashery did or didn't do as an entity irrelevant, and makes what's coming out of this conversation, which is illuminating to someone who's been active in the world of diversity and fighting for it. You know, I don't think until today I even really understood or thought enough about what Latina means. And I've known you since we were in our 20s. So let alone Mr. White Guy, whoever that might be, right? So thank God that finally this conversation is happening. We all have a lot of prejudices that constantly inform everything that we talk about. I heard them tonight. Assumptions, Jacques. We don't know what juries of Canada Council go through and discuss. I've heard a lot of prejudice here from a primarily theater crowd about film. You know what? I love film and TV. I think some of the most amazing shit and some of the most progressive stuff. I see it in pabulum like Mindy Kaling's show. Sopranos is one of my favorite things that I ever saw. And this is where I agree in something with John. I asked John, I watched The Sopranos. Yes, I like to see an actor pretend they're Italian-American, and there is a relish in seeing someone succeed in doing that. But if predominantly in The Sopranos they weren't Italian-Americans, I would have been really pissed off. And I'm not even Italian-American. I think that that authenticity that they brought to those amazing roles really made it something else that it couldn't have been. And I get irritated by colorblind casting as well, as opposed to color conscious casting. Because you know what? Sometimes I want to go see a German play, and I want to see a German person play a German play. I don't want to see a Persian guy play a German guy. Sometimes it's okay. It depends on the context. How do we start? I think it's really brave. I'm trying to touch so many things. You're talking about the personal responsibility. I don't want to put the responsibility as someone who's been a producer on an actor who's a woman who barely can get work in this city, and the older you get it, the more difficult it gets, and then all of a sudden have to have the burden of making that choice as well. The choice has to come with the power. And when we look at the power and we look at where the funding goes, and we have to look at all the power. It's easy to blame the arts club. She's not here. I will say this to her as well. I want to hear Donna's side of this as well. Because those of us who say we fight for diversity and have been doing it for a long time, we got to make sure when we're in power, we walk the walk as well. So yes, this is an honorable man. He's going to stick up with that. But you know, once the fire hall got involved, that did change the game a little bit. And I think, let's not point the picture. I like what you said, ma'am, about blind spots. Until we're all willing to have personal accountability for our own prejudices, and we all have them, I know damn well that I do,
my wife, who's white, but also has Aboriginal heritage, pointed that out to me several times. then we're lost. I think what's, and also, if we can move beyond and acknowledge that looking back is not useful, looking forward, and what I see here, God, if only 5 people had showed up tonight, that would have really depressed me. Look at the people who came out. And people were afraid. People were going, what's going to happen? Is there going to be fisticuffs? I want to see Don and David hug tonight. You know, like no. Right? But you know, it doesn't matter what people say all sorts of things in the heat of the moment, right? What's the actual actions that we took place? And the action that I see tonight is a lot of people came out. Carmen's been very clear. She's never changed her word from day one. She stuck with it. A lot of people came out. And at the end of the day, people from Haberdashery came out and were having a wonderful conversation. And thanks for everyone, to everyone.
So that was lovely. We have, there's about 15 minutes left, so in light of there being a little bit of confusion about the order of who wants to speak, could I ask people who would still like to speak to raise their hands, and for those who feel like they don't need to speak or their moment has passed, to leave their hands down. Okay, so, and yeah, and if people, if you have spoken already, if you could maybe put your hand down as well, that would be great, given time. So I'm going to go clockwise now, okay, so we're going to reset a bit, so we're going to go with Valerie, then we're going to go around this way, to the back, here, Jane, and finish with Halimia. Yes. That's good. Okay. So, if you give, in the interest of time, please. Obviously, the conversation requires some discussion. I don't want to limit that, but at the same time, if we could keep it moving forward and keep responses to a respectful length, and I'll ask those that put up their hand to help me, and others to not add themselves in the middle. That'd be great. So we'll start with Helen.
Thank you. So once again, my name is Valerie Singh Turner. I don't know if I mentioned that earlier. I am a performer, a playwright, and an emerging director, and I have been an advocate for cultural diversity for more years than I want to admit to. So the thing, when I talk about cultural diversity and the issues surrounding it, I always like to connect it back to the artistic side of things, because a lot of times we feel like cultural diversity is separate from the work we do as artists. And as an artist of Asian descent, I do not have the privilege or the luxury to separate my culture from my work. I do not have that privilege. But I also want to talk about the artistic respect and integrity for the person who's not really, you know, in this discussion, the writer, the writer's intentions, what the writer wanted when he created, in this case, the motherfucker in the hat. I had wanted to know why he decided he wanted 3 Latino characters in the center of his play. What was his vision of that? Why did he want to create that world? When we make plays, we create a world, right? And I just wanted to read out a portion of a letter by the president of the Dramatists Guild, written on November 18, 2015, to address, because there were many things. There was Katori Hall's The Mountaintop, when someone cast a white European descent man as Martin Luther King. There was another, I think, a Latino playwright who had written a play that had 2 South Asian characters from India, and white actors were cast in those roles, and he didn't find out about it until they were almost ready to produce it, and there was a big sort of fight also in social media, and got unpleasant, but he took away the rights and the play had to be canceled. And he also mentioned another production of The Motherfucker with the Hat in Hartford, where again, white actors were cast in the Latino roles. And so I just want to quote, "Play licenses clearly state that no changes to the play, including text, tone, and stage directions are permitted without the approval of the author. Casting is an implicit part of the stage directions. To pretend otherwise is disingenuous. When a play is still under copyright, directors must seek permission if they're going to make changes to the play, including casting a character outside of his or her obvious race, gender, or implicit characteristics. To do so without meaningful consultation with the writer is both a moral and a legal breach. One may agree or disagree with the views of a particular writer, but not with his or her autonomy over the play. Nor should writers be vilified or demonized for exercising it. This is entirely within well-established theatrical tradition. What's more, it's what the law requires and basic professional courtesy demands. And I just want to put that out there for us to think about, again, from the artistic thing, what is our vision when we decide to put on a play, or when we decide to write it, and when we decide to cast it? That's all I want to say about that.
Thank you for bringing the playwright into the room, and I believe the playwright is possibly in the room, just in case anybody's
The playwright is in the room. Hi, curious. Should I read what he wrote regarding...
That was not by the play, that was a different... That was not by the playwright, correct?
Can I ask that we stick to the speakers list because we're stretched for time and there are many people who've been waited.
Yeah, because and I think that was it was a thoughtful comment about the playwright's rights in general, and given the constraints of time, maybe we can.
Oh, sorry.
I would like to hear what he has to say at the end of the order because I think it's a very important thing we should all hear. It is from the playwright.
It is from the playwright of Mahabharata.
Sit down and let that be heard.
It's important to be heard. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
The room
he wrote, should I read it?
I would prefer to hear, John, with all due respect, several people who've been waiting. I understand that you've got a point you want to make. I will stay after 9 o'clock to hear it, but I think it's important that the voices that have not been heard be heard.
Yeah.
And then this is the voice of the playwright.
That can also be found posted on Facebook on his page. And these opinions can't be heard after this forum.
We'll spend so much time discussing. Let's just go around and then have interviews.
Yeah. Let's continue in the order and we will come back to this.
Hi, I'm Murray. So I have a few things that I kind of want to say on this topic. And I've kind of been sitting and listening to everybody talk about this entire thing. And I think everybody has brought up some really interesting and important points. So I just got back from a trip to New York and I saw two plays. The first was The Gin Game with Cicely Tyson and James Earl Jones. And the second was The Color Purple. And I have to say that that was the first time that I've ever seen not only one play, but two plays with all black casts. And I think that it's important to see a representation of yourself on stage or on screen. I also watched the Kennedy Center Honors, and two of the people were honored this year, Rita Moreno and Cicely Tyson. Some of the people who spoke to honor them both mentioned how important it was for their development as artists to be able to see somebody who looks like them on stage. And I think that as much as it's an ethical dilemma, as much as you should cast the plays appropriately for ethical reasons, I think it's also just to give people a chance to be seen and to eliminate the erasure, you know?
Yes.
And I know a few people have already touched on the subject of editorial intent, and I will post on Facebook. I read this article a couple of days ago from, it was an interview of Lin-Manuel. He just did Hamilton, and that's blowing up on Broadway right now. He basically has this commentary on authorial intent and race and casting and stuff, and I think it'll be an interesting read for everybody. And the last thing that, I mean, I realize now that we're kind of short on time, but if we ever do another one of these forums, I would think that it'd be, as much as discussion is important, action is more important.
Mm-hmm.
And speaking for myself, I know that I've had these conversations on race almost on a weekly basis. And it's, talk is cheap. So it's like, what do you want to do?
Yeah. We're gonna go here and then right behind you.
Hi,
Hi, everyone. My name is Barbara Chirinos. I am the executive director of the Granville Island Cultural Society. So I come from a different perspective, although I started in theater about 30 years ago in New York. I started as a lighting tech and then went on to become a stage manager for off-Broadway plays and taking tours across the United States. And then I came to Vancouver. Theater completely changed for me, a different perspective. But now working on Granville Island, where we manage four theaters, I see theater companies that come through all the time. And there's one question that many of them have in common. Why are there no people here? How come we are not selling tickets? What is it that we have to do? What do you know, what chain do we have to be a part of? How do we promote? The one thing that a lot of people are forgetting is that the stories that I see that are being told here on a large scale basis are not reflecting this.
Exactly.
The business part of show business, the people that make up Vancouver want to see theater, but it's not the same audiences that were going to theater 30, 20, 15, 10 years ago. People, women who are over the age of 40, that are single, divorced, have children, men that are over the age of 50, 60, Latinos, and yes, I am a black Latina from New York City, so I also relate to that as well. But they're about stories. That is what we're all talking about. Mm-hmm. People want to see stories that they can relate to. And going forward, and it's something that I've done that has been successful on a smaller scale here, are community collaborations. So if there are two companies that can essentially collaborate together to pick a project, so let's say it is Carmen's Association collaborating with Haberdashery, and together you pick a project that then Latinos will then come for casting, women of color will come for casting, people will come for casting for your production company, but it is a collaboration that starts at the beginning. So, you know, you decide who's going to be the director, you decide who's going to be the producer, you decide what sort of characters are going to be in that play that reflect the new population of Vancouver, so you can sell some goddamn tickets. Because that is what it's about. People want to see stories that they can relate to, and so you're not constantly going and feeding that same old list. I mean, Arts Club is great, they've got a subscription, you know, plan that's really fantastic, but every time I go, it's lots of times it's the same people. But and a lot of people want to translate that into, oh well, you know, black people don't want to go see plays.
Why?
You know, Latinos don't want to go see plays. We look out in the audience, we don't see them there, because their stories are not being reflected. But if we combine the best of what we have, you know, and we look at it culturally and collaborate, a true collaboration, because this conversation is going to continue going on forever until we look at a plan to move forward. Mm-hmm. And looking at it from the artistic point of view, but also from the producer's point of view, because you want to sell those tickets, and there are lots of people out there that want to come and see a show, but they're not seeing any properties out there with stories that, you know, look, there's somebody in the play that looks like me. Oh, I want to take my child there because there's somebody in the play that looks like her or looks like him. But those stories are not being selected. And there are plays coming out of South Africa, Mexico, New York, Toronto, George C. Clark. I stage managed a play for him here at the Cult about 10 years ago. Completely culturally diverse, and George Clark has now become the poet laureate for Canada, and he is in Toronto. So if we want to move forward, yeah, we can look at playing, who did this, it's a great learning experience. I think everybody here is really responsible, which is really fantastic, because you're taking responsibility for theater. That is why we're here. Mm-hmm. We love what we do. We want it to exist, and we want it to be sustainable. But, you know, if I see Chekhov one more time.
is now. That's all I have to say.
Good evening. My name is Mark Johnson, and I'm working for Boston. Been in Vancouver since about 2002. I'm a patron of the arts. I'm not an artist. But I've lived in a lot of different places. I moved here from Los Angeles. And I've been challenged myself increasingly over time with the plays that I've seen, productions that I've seen, both here and some that visit here. And how overwhelmingly white they are. That is not to take away from the quality or the artistic talent that's on the stage, but it's to talk about the way in which white supremacy is enacted in the where and where we live. Mm-hmm. And the fact that we don't challenge that. If I were to put on a play and had all female parts and only men played them, people would raise a question. At the very least. And, you know, I think it's wonderful also to see things like King Lear being done with an all-female cast. Woo! Right? So people say, what can we do that's different, that's revolutionary, that's transformative? What's going to make it vibrant? I can't go to plays now with all-white cast. I won't do it. I was invited to go see, what was it, the Christmas play, originally Jimmy Stewart, all-white. Yes, wonderful. I love that. That's a wonderful white cast. It's not to say anything bad about white people. It's not about white people. It's about the structure of the way in which theater is performed in this city. We have to transform that. We have to open up our hearts and minds and transform that. If we had all male stages all the time with maybe one or two women in it, people would say, oh my God, how can we do that? So we have to come up with an intelligent way to really make this happen. And stop justifying, explaining, well, the poet said this, or the playwright said this, and this and that. Come on, people, we can be imaginative, but we can imagine E.T., we can certainly imagine a black person a different kind of role, right? Or a Latino person, or an Asian person, or an Aboriginal person, right? I mean, we can imagine fucking creatures out of space. You can't imagine a person who actually inhabits a planet, occupy a role. Come on. Yeah.
that's given us the opportunity to have this conversation and to go forward. And one of the most hopeful things for me was what you said, John, and I think I wrote it down properly. You said, it wasn't in our psyche as much as it should have been and as much as it will be from now on.
Mm-hmm.
And for me, that's what this is about. Majority culture, and I'm a person of privilege. And I have to constantly be acknowledging my own blinkers and my own, you know, the things I think. I'm not oppressing somebody, I'm not stepping on somebody, and I am. But if we're all doing that, if we're all being as conscious as we can be, if we're all nudging each other and saying, have you thought about this, what about this, what about looking at a different play rather than a play that is telling a story from a culture that we haven't heard of? What about if we're doing Shakespeare or we're doing Chekhov, opening the doors to a wider casting than the one that we think traditionally? You're going to change. And for me, it's not about what is politically correct, which is another term I loathe. It's not just about social doing the right thing. It's also, and a number of people have said this, and I just want to underline that, it's about doing better art.
Mm-hmm.
And if we do that, because I am Jewish, and we have a lot in common with Italians, but we're not Italian. And if I were a better actor and I tried to play an Italian, maybe I'd get some of it, but I probably wouldn't get what you just walk on the stage and you have, because that's who you are. In the same way that I, as a Jewish woman, walking up and doing that. Or when Anthony Holland, who was 82 years old, played King Lear, he didn't have to act the 82-year-old. He just acted who he was. And I still see that wonderful actors play Lear if they weren't the right age. And so, and that's true too. I get as upset about the fact that I see 30-year-old women playing 60-year-old women when there are so few roles for women who are in their 60s, as I do about the fact that we don't get to see Latino or Latina actresses, that we don't, you know, so we are in a country that deprives its artists of the funding to do what we should do, so we're all beleaguered, there's not enough work for anybody, so we either say, fuck that, and find a way to open the tent, to open the doors so that there are more opportunities for everybody. Because I think what breaks my heart about this is there's an actor of color who is probably marginalized also and not able to do things, and so he picks a play because he falls in love with it, but he doesn't think about the fact that when he's going for that, he's ending up marginalizing other people. And so, but part of that has to do with the fact that there isn't enough, but there could be. And if we were conscious and we made more noise like this, and we make more noise with our audiences, and we make more noise with this page 2015, 2016 government, so that we get more funding and we get more support, we could start doing more work all around. And then there are practical ways to do that, but it starts with the consciousness. It starts with saying, I'm not going to walk out this door and go, phew, okay, I've done enough. And go back to my old comfortable way of working. I'm going to stay in a place that makes me slightly uncomfortable because I really don't know what I'm doing. And I'm going to stay as conscious as I can. And I'm going to hope that anybody around here is going to remind me to be conscious and that I'm doing the same thing with everybody else. And then what? And then all we can do is the best we can do.
That is action. Hearts changing. That's as much action as breaking down walls as well. So thank you very much.
So, yeah, in the interest of time, it is 9 o'clock. I would, Jane mentioned this article in American Theatre. I was going to read a bit of this. I won't. But I encourage you to read it because if you go online, it's part of American Theatre magazine. It's called Standing Up for the Playwrights and Against Colorblind Casting. And while it sort of cuts through the bullshit in a really nice way, because it sort of says, yes, it's a complex, nuanced issue, but there's a few things that we all should know by now. And so it's a really great thing to read. And I'd also like to say, in the interest of action, I'm not going to go anywhere. I represent an organization that is interested in this question right now. I'm going to a board meeting in Toronto in a couple of weeks, and would love to hear anybody that has any ideas that might be actionable. I don't know if Valerie has to go anywhere. I don't know if Jane has to go anywhere. There's other people in the room that represent different organizations and interests. I don't think we're in any rush to leave the room, but I would like, I think it is time to bring the conversation to a close. I would like, at the end of the as part of the end of the conversation, is to give John one last chance to speak. You don't have to necessarily read the playwright's intentions if you don't want.
Well, the only reason why I suggested it was.
Just let me finish the ending bit. But I'd like to give you a chance to speak and sort of have your final piece that hopefully I think in the tenor of the conversation. Just a second.
Yeah, you didn't finish the circle.
I did not finish the circle. It did not. I apologize to all of those. I did not finish the circle. I'm just gonna say that I think we did have a time limit on it. We've already blown over it. We're gonna stick to it. I am saying that we do not have to leave the room, that the conversation can continue. What I'm proposing, unless you rush me and bowl me over, before we see people start to trickle out and the conversation slowly fizzle, I would like to give Haberdashery a chance to have some parting remarks. I'd like to give Pedro and Carmen a chance to have some parting remarks, and then at that point, I will relieve myself of my duties and this room. I live here kind of, so I'll stick around and keep this space open until the last person leaves.
And John's not trying to have the last word. He's actually trying to give the playwright who actually took the time to be here.
Not everybody
is on Facebook, guys. I think we should.
No, and that's why I think it's important that we I know we're truncating the conversation, but it really could go on all night.
Yeah.
I want a chance for, this production is opening up shortly. I'm sure it's going to be fabulous. And now
it better be, huh?
Yeah. Well, but it is important to acknowledge that.
Yeah. Yeah, we're fucked.
No, it's important to acknowledge that the purpose of this conversation was not to submarine the production, right? The purpose of the conversation was to talk about these issues, and I do congratulate everybody here. I think we largely stayed on talking about it in a bigger, more holistic and forward-thinking way, and that's no small task, especially considering how we got, some of the things that happened since we got here. And other people have summed that up more eloquently than I have, but it is worth acknowledging. And so, if you would like,
if Stephen is listening, thank you, Stephen, for a beautiful play and for listening in. The only last word I want to have personally is that I'm really glad that I actually did bring my son, because when he talked to me about it, I said, "This is an education. It's time to get an education." Mm-hmm. And maybe 20 years from now, you'll remember this meeting. You'll remember. You know what, I went to this meeting and it was about this topic and that topic, and maybe you'll become an activist or you'll become something that way. So I appreciate what has happened here, as difficult as it is to be walking in this door today, and difficult knowing that I gotta be on stage in a week with all you guys with your judgmental attitudes looking at me going, I'm safe on that level of ethnicity with the character, but so we were very panicky at one time because we started reading online that Girgis would shut us down because of the Hartford situation. And we were going to rehearsal freaking out because we're like, what are we doing, blah, blah, blah. And one of our castmates, Lori Triolo, Ray started a theater company above a pizzeria in the Bronx about 20 years ago with Girgis. And so she had not reached out to him all the way until about 2 days ago. And then she just reached out to him because we were freaking out. We're like, maybe we're gonna now get shut down. And he wrote this, and some people are on Facebook and they saw it and some people are not, so I'm just gonna read it. And this is, please, 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 not to be interpreted as me trying to get any kind of last word or last I just found out about this yesterday. Productions like this one get licensed by the DPS, the play's publisher. I have an old friend who's involved in the production. I spoke to her yesterday at length. I believe what she told me. I think the process may have been imperfect, but I do not believe this is a situation like in Hartford, in fact, it's nothing like Hartford. I also told her that, if need be, I'd go out to Vancouver and do a talk back and open it up to anyone in the community who wants to engage. There is still such blatant non-inclusion and institutionalized racism in our society and in our theater, and clearly it must be challenged and changed and smashed to pieces. But also, at some point down the road, we probably do need a better definition of what white people means. Three of the five characters in my play were written as New York Ricans. The lead actor is, I'm told, Portuguese, Italian, and Middle Eastern. That's Lobo he's talking about. The woman playing Veronica is some kind of Anglo, but offered to step down. And the third New York Rican is Chilean. And if wrong shit went down, there's no excuse. But also, this is a production in Vancouver. The total Latino population there is about 1.3%. I don't know. I don't live there. I don't know the talent pool. I only know a little bit about the genesis of the production. I'm willing to learn more, but it feels like a situation where there has been perhaps some contempt prior to examination. There's definitely no Puerto Ricans in this production, but it sounds to me like a cast of multi-ethnic actors, mostly from New York City, which many of us are, who just wanted to do a play, spent 2 years trying to get it off the ground, and are now doing a 2-week run in Vancouver. Again, I'm willing to learn more, and especially if you're from Vancouver, please feel free to reach out to me, and Carmen did. In the meantime, I support the actors and the production, and I hope good comes out of both the production and the controversy. That's you.
Thank you for that. That was great. That was really great. I think so. I think that would be.
Yes. So I don't know if Stephen is even watching. Or thank you very much for that commentary. I do need to say that I was disappointed that you made a statement about this production without talking to us first. It would have been great if you talked to both sides before you made a public statement like that. I know for myself, I am a playwright. If I heard about a play of mine happening in Norway and there was a big article about it in the major newspaper of Norway saying that an ethnic minority was protesting something about the play, I would definitely speak to both sides before I made a statement. So thank you for your statement, and I am disappointed that you didn't do that. And I want to thank everybody for coming tonight. There's so much more to say from my end. I'm sure Pedro has 5 million things to say. Alexandra, who's in Guatemala City, who's probably already chewed off her entire lip. And all the Latinos in the room, I wish the Latinos had spoken more,
yes,
because it was called a conversation with the Latino theater community or with the Latino community. I was so happy that African Canadians, I don't know if I'm saying the right terminology here, spoke. I love it when that happens. And I really wish all the Latinos who are here tonight who really wanted to speak and who told me that they really wanted to speak would have stood up and said, everybody else shut up. This is my conversation and you are here to witness it. I just wish you had done that more. That's all.
Yeah. Thank you everyone for coming. It means a lot. As a young-ish, I'm not the youngest in the room, artist in the city, it means a lot to have you all come out when I decide to speak up on something and to have support and to have counterpoints, and it means a lot and it warms my heart to know that moving forward as an artist in the city that these conversations can happen, and I've come to a point where I'm no longer afraid to speak up, mm-hmm, and that when it does happen that it will continue to come. HowlRound for hosting the live stream and Playwrights Theatre Centre for lending us the equipment. Everyone here at PL who let us be in this building, especially New World, who has rehearsal tomorrow in this space. So when we if anyone does want to stick around and help reset, that'll be great. Thank you.
Steven.
Oh, and Steven for tuning in. He did. Oh yeah. If you guys were wondering, he did check in on Twitter that he was listening. And so thank you for everyone speaking and Steven for listening to this conversation. Thank you.